Welcome back, and now for the news in detail. We start our news bulletin from U.S. President Donald Trump, who has appreciated Pakistan's role against terrorism. Addressing a gathering in India's Ahmedabad city, Trump said Washington has very good relations with Islamabad. Due to security concerns, U.S. President addressed the crowd from behind a bulletproof glass enclosure. Trump said India has an important role to play for peace and stability in the region. The president said he hopes for reduced tensions in future for all South Asian nations.
Our relationship with Pakistan is a very good one. Thanks to these efforts, we are beginning to see signs of big progress with Pakistan, and we are hopeful for reduced tensions, greater stability, and the future of harmony for all of the nations of South Asia. India has an important leadership role to play in shaping a better future as you take on greater responsibility for solving problems and promoting peace throughout this incredible region.
In New Delhi, a policeman has been killed in violent clashes after several demonstrators were beaten up during a protest against the citizenship law. This comes as U.S. President Donald Trump arrives in Delhi as part of his first state visit to India. Now moving on, Malaysia's Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad has sent his resignation to the King. In a statement, Mahathir's Bersatu Party said the leader has also quit the party as the chairman. The Home Minister said the Bersatu Party has left the ruling coalition as well. The fate of Malaysia's ruling coalition had been in doubt after surprise weekend talks between it and opposition groups on forming a new government. The new government would exclude Mahathir's anointed successor, Anwar Ibrahim. It was not immediately clear if Mahathir could form another government with the support of the other parties. Ibrahim had accused his party of plotting to form a new government with the United Malays National Organization. The tussle between old rivals Mahathir and Anwar has shaped Malaysian politics for decades. Tensions have persisted despite their alliances to win the country's 2018 elections. For more on this, we are joined by James Dorsey, political analyst from Singapore. Thank you for joining us. Malaysian Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad has resigned not only as a Prime Minister, but from the chairmanship of his party as well. How far out of the race to form a new government does this put him?
The speculation is that his party will be forming a coalition with another political party, possibly UMNO, the party that was once led by the former Prime Minister Najib Razak, who's currently on trial on corruption charges.
Mr. Dorsey, if no group has more than 112 members needed for a parliamentary majority, fresh elections are an option. What are the chances of the fresh polls?
It's possible that it would go to fresh elections, but I think it's more likely that you will see a coalition government emerge from this. Keep in mind that this is not a resignation and a pullout from the government because of differences within the government. It's a strategic move, most likely calculated to disrupt the agreement that Mohamed Mahathir had made initially prior to his election 2 years ago, in which he was going to share power or transfer power after 2 years to his former Deputy Prime Minister Anwar Ibrahim, with whom he's had a very troubled relationship.
Mr. Dorsey, why does Mahathir Mohamad want to keep Ibrahim Anwar out of power despite his commitment to share the government? What was the reason behind it?
The two men have never seen eye to eye, really. And the former Deputy Prime Minister Anwar Ibrahim has been repeatedly in prison and is again being investigated on sodomy charges that most people would view as having been trumped up. This agreement was made when Mahathir Mohamad decided to run again for elections 2 years ago, and he formed this alliance, which led to the release of Anwar Ibrahim from prison.
That was James Dorsey, political analyst from Singapore. Thank you very much for your time. Now, moving on, the UN says Libya's warring sides have proposed a draft ceasefire deal that will see displaced civilians return to their homes. In a statement, the UN support mission in Libya said it will facilitate the ceasefire process. More in this report. The second round of indirect talks between Libya's government and Khalifa Haftar's forces has resulted in a draft ceasefire deal. According to the UN, the draft proposes the formation of a military commission with members from both sides. This commission will monitor the safe return of the displaced civilians to their homes. The UN said the warring sides would meet again next month to discuss implementation terms, but prospects for a lasting truce still remain unclear. Speaking at the UN Human Rights Council, Faisal Sarraj accused Haftar of violating human rights in Libya. He also decried international inaction over hostilities raging on the ground. Meanwhile, lawmakers aligned with Haftar have announced to suspend their participation in political peace talks. Libya has been mired in turmoil since the toppling of strongman Muammar Gaddafi in 2011. The Israeli military says it has bombed the self-styled Islamic Jihad group in Syria and Gaza, killing six fighters. The war monitor confirmed six pro-Syrian government fighters were killed in Damascus in overnight airstrikes. The Israeli military said the attack was launched in retaliation for rockets attack in Israel. The Syrian military said most missiles were destroyed before reaching their targets. In Syria, five people have been killed in Russian airstrikes backing Syrian forces as they chip away as the country's last major rebel bastion. A war monitor said the deadly raids hit the area of Jabal al-Zabiya in the south of the rebel-dominated stronghold of Idlib. The Syrian Observatory for Human Rights said regime forces have rapidly gained ground in the southern part of Idlib in the past 24 hours. State media said units of Syrian army continue to progress in the south of Idlib. The recent advances have sent over a million civilians fleeing towards the border with Turkey. Ankara has called for an immediate halt to the attacks and for the ceasefire to be followed. Meanwhile, Syrians forced to flee the Russian-backed government assault in the country's northwest say they are living in wretched conditions. They said the situation is exacerbated by cold winds and freezing temperatures. The latest offensive targeting rebel strongholds in Aleppo and Idlib has uprooted 1 million people, mostly women and children. More in this report.
At a makeshift camp in Azaz, dozens have crowded into tents in an attempt to find shelter from the harsh winter. Families are sleeping outside by roads and in olive groves, burning garbage to stay warm. Some children have died from the cold. The Raaf Ahmed said children sick from the cold were taken to the hospital in an ambulance.
It is very cold. A few days ago, it even snowed. The children got sick and we had to take them to hospital in an ambulance. The situation is miserable.
One woman said her tent collapsed under the weight of snow, leaving the family without shelter. She also said the situation is grim.
That tent you see there fell on us when it snowed. It got ripped, so I left it on the ground. We are cold and tired. You can see the situation with your own eyes. The conditions are at their worst.
Meanwhile, the UN Humanitarian Affairs Agency, OCHA, said the crisis has reached a horrifying level. It said more than 300 people, many of them women and children, had been killed in Idlib and Aleppo due to the hostilities since the start of the year.
The European Commission says the remaining parties to the Iran nuclear deal will meet in Vienna on Wednesday. China, Russia, France, Germany and the UK will try to find ways to uphold the 2015 agreement with Tehran. The office of the EU diplomatic chief, Joseph Borrell, said the get-together will be chaired on his behalf by senior official Helge Schmidt. Borrell is tasked with convening the commission under the dispute mechanism. He has said he believes all the countries still in the deal are determined to save the accord. On 14th of January, France, Germany and the UK triggered a formal dispute mechanism over Tehran's breaches of key parts of the nuclear deal. The meeting comes as the European parties try to find a way to persuade Iran to come back into line with the deal. Moving on, four people have been killed and six others wounded in two separate attacks in Iraq's capital Baghdad and the Diyala province. In a statement, police said unknown attackers killed a traffic police officer as well as a civilian in eastern Baghdad. The statement said a civil servant was killed in southern city by armed assailants riding a motorbike. It said three other people were wounded by an explosion and armed attacks in the southern sections of the city. Iraq's defense ministry said ISIS killed one civilian and wounded three security forces in Diyala province. The militant group has not yet claimed the responsibility for the attack. In the Iraqi city of Najaf, the grave of slain paramilitary leader Abu Mehdi al-Muhandis has become a magnet for Shia Muslims with grievances against the U.S. Muhandis was killed in a U.S. drone strike alongside Iran's General Qasem Soleimani early last month. Anti-American sentiment has boomed in the region ever since. This report has the details.
The U.S. long considered Muhandis its number one enemy in Iraq. But Iraqis know him as a hero who saved the country from ISIS.
He is the man who defeated ISIS and he is a hero. May he rest his peace. His death affected the entire Iraqi army and the Hashd forces.
Today, the paramilitary commander's grave is bustling with visitors around the clock.
They come to visit the grave of Abu Mahdi. All days of the week, the visits never stop. Ever since he died and until the 40th day after his death, the number of visitors has been tremendous.
For now, the people at this shrine are the least of Washington's worries. The US is likely more concerned about armed Iraqi factions that have vowed to avenge the assassination of Muhandis. The country hosts 5,200 U.S. troops, and while they haven't come under attack from within Iraq yet, they still have a target on their backs that wasn't there prior to the killing of Muhandis and Qasem Soleimani.
Stay for a short break. We'll be right back. Stay tuned. Welcome back. In China, 150 people have died in the last 24 hours from the new coronavirus outbreak, raising the death toll to almost 2,600. The National Health Commission says there are 409 more infections, pushing the total past 77,000. Beijing has allocated $14.16 billion to contain and curb the outbreak. Details in this report.
The new coronavirus has tested China's resilience like few other things in recent times. But it's becoming a serious issue outside China as it spreads to new countries and threatens to take hold in places it is already present. There are now 1,200 cases spread across at least 30 countries. In South Korea, 161 more cases have appeared, taking their total to 763. The country has raised its disease alert to the highest level.
Especially in Daegu, a large number of confirmed cases have been reported. If we don't block the spread in the Daegu regions in an effective way, there is a high possibility that it would end to a nationwide transmission.
Italy has reported its third death in the outbreak, but the European Union says there is no need for a COVID-19 panic. Speaking to reporters at the G20 summit in Riyadh, EU Finance Minister Paolo Gentiloni said the bloc has full confidence in the Italian authorities.
What I would say on the subject is, one, that we EU has full confidence on the Italian authorities and on the decisions that they are taking. There is no reason for panic, and there is a need to follow the instruction of public and health authorities.
In the meantime, Turkey, Pakistan, and Armenia have closed their borders with Iran after it reported confirmed cases of the virus.
Kuwait, Bahrain, and Iraq have confirmed their first novel coronavirus cases. Health ministries in the three countries said all had come from Iran. Kuwait reported three infections, while Bahrain and Iraq one. Last week, Kuwait Airways and Iraq Airways suspended flights to Iran, while Saudi Arabia suspended all travel to Iran. Turkish Airlines have cancelled its flights to four Iranian cities and decreased the frequency of flights to Tehran until 27th of February. At Kuwait's request, Iraq has shut its Safwan border crossing with the country to travelers and trade. In Iran, the confirmed death toll climbed by 4 to 12, the highest number of fatalities for any other country outside of China. Earlier, the Iranian government denied there had been 50 deaths and pledged transparency. In Italy, officials have cut short the Venice Carnival to control what is now the worst outbreak of the coronavirus in Europe. The authorities in Veneto region said the event will end 2 days earlier than planned. Italy has imposed quarantine restrictions in two northern hotspot regions close to Milan and Venice. Nearly 50,000 people cannot enter or leave several towns in Veneto and Lombardy for the next 2 weeks without special permission. Many businesses and schools have suspended activities, while sporting events have also been cancelled. The government says the army is prepared to step in if needed to enforce the perimeter. Italy has reported the highest number of coronavirus cases in Europe at 132, with 3 deaths. In a court hearing in the UK, Julian Assange's lawyer says his client should not be extradited to the US. Edward Fitzgerald said extradition will expose Assange to inhumane and degrading treatment. Fitzgerald warned Assange would be a suicide risk and would face a disproportionate sentence. He said the extradition request was motivated by politics rather than any genuine crimes. Meanwhile, hundreds of Assange supporters marched through the streets of Sydney calling for his release. Australians decried his extradition hearing in London. WikiLeaks founder spent 7 years in Ecuador's embassy in London. Initially, he fled there to avoid extradition to Sweden, where he was accused of rape. He was forced out of the embassy last year and is being held at a high-security prison in London. In Myanmar, police have arrested 6 student union members for organizing a protest against an 8-month internet blackout in the former capital, Yangon. They have been charged under Section 19 of the Peaceful Assembly Law, which outlaws unauthorized gatherings and carries a 3-month prison sentence. Authorities in Myanmar first shut down mobile internet access in 9 townships in the western states of Chin and Rakhine last June. Internet access was restored in 5 of these townships but cut off again earlier this month. Hundreds of students protested against the move in Yangon and 2 Rakhine townships over the weekend. Students complained the internet blackout had disrupted academic life.
We cannot connect with our parents and siblings. We are studying here by the support of our families. If we don't get any connection and money from our families, how can we still study?
In the Democratic Republic of Congo, security forces have killed 6 allied Democratic Forces fighters in 2 operations over the weekend. The army said the main action took place in the area east of Beni City in the northeastern part of the country. An army spokesman said 1 ADF member has been captured alive and 1 soldier was wounded in the operations. He went on to say the DRC's armed forces adapted their tactics to the ADF threat and are able to intercept terrorists before they attack. The ADF began as a Ugandan rebel group opposed to President Yoweri Museveni. The group is accused of killing 400 civilians since November last year. 30 people have been wounded in a bombing at a rally in support of Ethiopia's Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed. Police said they have arrested 6 suspects. The authorities said the attack was probably carried out by the Oromo Liberation Army, the armed wing of the Oromo Liberation Front opposition party. The attack happened as Ethiopia's electoral board is preparing for parliamentary elections scheduled for the 29th of August. The formal campaign period will begin in May. Officials say Prime Minister Abiy was not present at the rally. Two protesters have been killed during police-backed anti-government demonstrations in Haiti's capital of Port-au-Prince. The defense ministry says shots were fired during clashes at a carnival while the army-guarded stage was also torched. Officials said troops fired tear gas and assault rifles at protesters. The police timed the protest for the first day of the festival to criticize the government's spending priorities. Protesters carried guns, marched from the upscale Delmas neighborhood towards the large Champs de Mars public square. Haitian police have been demanding better working conditions, in particular, the right to form a union.
We don't want carnival. Second, we support the police protest who are demanding a union. The lack of security in this country is the fault of President Jovenel Moïse. He uses the army to destroy the police. Various police officers have been wounded by bullets. There is one who died. We say to the people that we need to keep going until the end.
In Germany, CDU leader Annegret Kramp-Karrenbauer says the party will hold a special congress to decide on a new leader on 25th of April. She said the potential candidates will announce if they are running within the week. Earlier this month, Kramp-Karrenbauer, German Chancellor Angela Merkel's heir apparent, resigned as party leader. The resignation followed a controversy surrounding the ruling CDU's cooperation with the far-right AfD party in the eastern state of Thuringia. Kramp-Karrenbauer said the choosing of a new party leader will send a clear signal about CDU's candidate for chancellor in next year's federal election. Angela Merkel has been chancellor for almost 15 years and has already confirmed she will not be running again. China's top legislative body has banned the wildlife trade and consumption of meat taken from the wild animals. The National People's Congress Standing Committee said the decision was taken to protect people's health and lives. The NPC's decision will see tougher sentences handed to violators than China's existing laws on wildlife protection. Conservationists have long accused Beijing of taking a lax approach to protecting wildlife. There is a demand for wild animals in China as exotic menu items and for use in traditional medicines. The decision comes after the COVID-19 virus was traced back to the wildlife market in Wuhan. The 2003 SARS outbreak was also traced to the consumption of wild animals' meat. Following that outbreak, Chinese authorities had implemented a temporary ban on wildlife trade. A vast sandstorm from the African Sahara Desert has shrouded Spain's Canary Islands, disrupting over 800 flights. Spain's airport operator ENA cancelled, suspended or diverted all the flights to and from the islands, citing low visibility. A state of alert was issued by the regional government on the weekend, with residents advised to stay indoors. The sandstorm is visible from space with satellite images showing it engulfing the islands off the coast of northwest Africa. A French street artist's interpretation of Mona Lisa, made using 330 ruby cubes, sold for $520,680 at an auction in Paris. Organizers say it was well above a pre-sale estimate of up to $162,000. More in this report.
Invader is an anonymous street artist known for his mosaic tile work featuring pixelated versions of the 1978 Space Invaders video game. The Rubik Mona Lisa was created in 2005 and is the first in Invader's Rubik Cubism series, in which he recreates well-known works.
You can distinguish it just from the shape. You almost don't need to see the details. You know it's the Mona Lisa simply because of the position, the composition, and that's what's magical. It's not the case with all of Invader's Rubik's works. Some of them are harder to get at.
The sale coincided with the closure of a blockbuster Leonardo da Vinci exhibition at the nearby Louvre Museum, the home of the real Mona Lisa. That show marked the 500th anniversary of the death of the Renaissance master.
They both embody their own eras. It's not the place to talk about Da Vinci's art here, but you could go on forever. Invader is in the same vein, someone who embodies his era.
Invader, who defines himself as an unidentified free artist, wears a mask and insists on his face being pixelated for rare appearances on camera. He has a large following of fans who use a smartphone app, Flash Invaders, to snap pictures of his mosaics.
In Italy, German designer Philipp Lein has put on a dazzling spectacle as he presented his fall 2020 collection at Milan Fashion Week. Along with the glittery clothes line, the show also featured some US celebrities dressed in sparkling costumes.
Philipp Lein, known for his over-the-top runways, launched his latest winter collection at Milan Fashion Week. Gold and silver tones dominated the show. Hoodies and latex miniskirts were also a recurrent theme for the show, which saw models walk around a customized fighter jet and speedboat. The designer Pinkett Smith and models wore sparkly jerseys and sweatshirts inspired by Bryant's Los Angeles Lakers number 24 jersey. Pliant told proceeds from the sales of the Bryant-inspired tops would be donated to Mamba and Mambacita Sports Foundation. The show also featured a performance by U.S. rapper and singer Tyga.
Brazil has kicked off its supercharged Rio Carnival in the bustling seaside city of Rio de Janeiro. The lively celebrations consist of samba competitions, parades and block parties, and a lot more. Let's find out in this report.
Thousands of revelers dressed in brilliant, bright and even outrageous costumes have taken to the Brazilian streets to celebrate the world's biggest and brightest carnival. On the first night, dancers from Rio's samba schools paraded in wild outfits through Rio's Sambadrome.
I am very excited and very moved by our parade. The expectation is for a great parade and to be a champion.
The samba schools and dance groups compete for the carnival title. While the processions are famous for their smiles, flamboyance and party atmosphere, the competition is fierce. Rio's Carnival is one of Brazil's biggest events, spanning several days up until Ash Wednesday. Traditionally, it's one of the country's loudest, most diverse festivals on the calendar, matching the melting pot nature of the country's population and history.
It is a very big emotion that makes me very nervous, very lively, but I'm confident.
The Rio de Janeiro's Carnival will run until February 26th.
More stories to follow right after a short break. Stay tuned with us. China says the new coronavirus outbreak has greatly affected country's economy. Assistant Finance Minister Wu Wenhan says Beijing has allocated $14 billion to combat impact brought by the disease. Wu said China's market demand for employment is falling, while major industries are running into difficulties with the production after resuming operations. Dubai International Financial Center said Beijing has shown strong capacity to control impact of the virus. The organization noted China's swift resumption of business operations in China means the outlook for China's economy in 2020 remains positive.
This epidemic has greatly affected our economy. From the very start, consumption during the Lunar Year holiday and the service industry were affected. Later on, for factories and companies that are just resuming work, some businesses, especially medium and small-sized businesses, have run into major difficulties with their production and operations.
Beijing has asked its banks to offer more credit for an economy as the virus spreads rapidly. Now moving on to the stock markets across Europe, which are trading lower after a surge in the novel coronavirus cases across the continent. Investors are on a selling spree as major stocks lose steam. Frankfurt's DAX is trading over 3.5% lower after Lufthansa stocks fell over 7.5%. CAC 40 in Paris has lost over 3.5% after Air France KLM shares dived over 7.5%. London's FTSE 100 has lost nearly 3% after EasyJet stocks plummeted over 10%. In Asia, Seoul's Kospi led the losses, closing nearly 4% lower after major airlines took a dip. Hong Kong's Hang Seng and Shanghai Composite lost ground. Meanwhile, international Brent crude oil price has plunged over 3% as global air travel falls amid coronavirus. Another weather situation from around the globe. That's all for now. For the latest updates, you can follow us on social media at Distop News.